Okay, open page 105 of your book, and you can see there is an example of copper chromate. Okay, this experiment is to prove the movement of ions. Okay, we know that the ions, they move towards their opposite electrodes, oppositely charged electrodes, like minus sign. It's the anion. The minus sign. Yeah, it's the anion. The negative one is anion and positive one is cation. Okay, these are the two ions. And we know that they move towards their oppositely charged electrodes. Like anion will move towards positive anode. And cation will move towards negative cathode. Okay, so we know this thing because we know it from grade 4 or 5 that oppositely charged ions attract each other, unlike charges attract each other. Okay, but right now in this experiment we will actually prove that oppositely charged ions that attracted towards their oppositely charged electrodes. Okay, so in this experiment we are using a colored compound copper chromate. Okay, the electrolyte which we use is copper chromate, CuCrO4, CuCrO4, and this one is this electrolyte is green in color. Okay, it's dark green in color. And what happens when we pass the electricity, then it will split into copper ions, Cu2+, plus chromate ions. Okay, CrO4 2-. These are copper ions. Copper ions are blue in color and chromate ions are yellow in color. So in water, these ions will show their colors. Okay, and here we are using electrodes, graphite electrodes. We are using graphite carbon. Okay, for carbon, to use the carbon, I told you that there are some points why we are using carbon. Do you know the points? The electrode. The electrode which we are using, it should be a conductor, number one. Number two. Does anyone remember?
Ma'am, it should be inert.
Yeah, very good. It should be inert, unreactive. Okay, and carbon is a good conductor and it's inert also, means it will not, it does not react with the chemicals and the ions. And also, like carbon is, I told you that carbon is very economical, it's cheap. Okay, and it's very abundant also. It's available in large quantity. So that is why carbon is the most feasible one to use, feasible material. Okay, so we use carbon in electrolysis mostly. Okay, carbon graphite. Now, the one which is connected with the negative terminal of the battery is cathode, negative. And then, and the one which is connected with the positive terminal is positive anode. Okay, because the materials, they are on the whole at the starting, they are neutral. We make them charged by connecting them with the battery, okay, with the terminals. Now, when the electricity is passed, it will split into copper and chromate ions. Now, copper ions, in this experiment, after a few minutes, we will see the blue color, we will observe blue color appearing on the cathode side. Okay, the one which is the electrode, which is connected with the negative terminal, on the negative side, we will see blue color. Okay, and on the positive side, we will see yellow color. What does it indicate? That which ions have moved towards negative side?
Positive.
Yeah, positive ions are copper ions. Okay, so the blue color indicates, the blue color appeared on the negative side, okay, the side which is connected with the negative terminal, the cathode. So blue color appeared over on that side. So it means that copper plus two means positive ions have moved towards negative side. Okay, and the positive side, the anode, there we will see yellow color. Okay, yellow color indicates that the chromate negative ions, they have moved towards positive side. So unlike charge attract each other. And okay, unlike charges. So this experiment is actually a proof of the movement of ions, that which ions are moving towards which electrodes. Okay, so now we know that opposite ions, they move towards positive and negative ions, they move towards their opposite electrodes. Okay, so this experiment is the proof of that, so it can come. Okay, this experiment is also really important. Okay, and why we are using dilute hydrochloric acid in it? it's written here in the labeling that there is hydrochloric acid at the top. Okay, in copper chromate is dark green in color. At the top of copper chromate, we put a small amount of hydrochloric acid. Okay, dilute hydrochloric acid is transparent in color. It is transparent. And hydrochloric acid is just a medium in which these ions will show their colors. Okay, because obviously copper chromate is still here. Okay, and it will not change its color when it will split into its ions. Okay, the ions will show their color if there is water medium present. Okay, water present, transparent medium is present. In dilute hydrochloric acid, there is water present. Okay, so in water, these ions will show their colors. Okay, otherwise, if any transparent material is not present or if any water is not present, so these ions will not produce colors. Okay, so transition metals, they show colors. The ions show their colors in aqueous form. Okay, and it's dilute hydrochloric acid, so there is water, hydrochloric acid in water. So then they will show their colors. That's why hydrochloric acid is present. Okay, so it provides a medium for the ions to show their colors. Okay, then on the next page, is this experiment clear, boys?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now on the next page, there is the example of zinc chloride. Okay, first a new topic is starting, electrolysis of molten compounds. Okay, molten compounds means liquid compounds, liquid or in melted form. Okay, they're just compounds by itself, no water present in them. Okay, we discussed that electrolyte can be taken in the molten form or in the aqueous form. Okay, so first we will discuss the molten form, and after this we will discuss the solutions. Okay, when they're dissolved in water. So in molten form, there is no water present, no water involvement in electrolyte. Okay, so they are just compounds in the liquid form. So first example is of zinc chloride on this page, on page 106. There is example of zinc chloride. Okay, and on the next page, page 107, this is an example of lead bromide. Okay, so these are two, there are two examples in your book. So let's discuss them one by one. And both of these examples are similar to each other. Okay, so if you understand the zinc chloride one, you can easily understand the lead bromide also. Okay, because both of them are same to same, only the chemicals are different. The elements are different. Otherwise, they are same. So the first one, first example of zinc chloride. Zinc can be extracted from zinc oxide by heating with carbon. So first method, the electrolysis basically is used to extract the metals. Okay, those metals which are very hard to extract, they can be extracted by electrolysis. Okay, so we will use there any ionic compound and we will extract the metal from it. Okay, so zinc chloride can be used to extract zinc. Okay, we will extract zinc from it. So zinc can be extracted from zinc oxide by heating with carbon. This is one of the methods by which zinc can be extracted, by heating with carbon or from zinc chloride by electrolysis. So this is the method in which we are interested. Okay, so we can extract zinc from zinc chloride by electrolysis. Zinc chloride must be heated until it is molten before it will conduct electricity. Electrolysis separates the molten ionic compound into its elements. So first it will, the zinc chloride ZnCl2 in the liquid form, okay, means in the molten form, it will first split into its ions. Okay, this is a sign of reversible reaction, and splitting into ions is known as ionization. Okay, ionization is splitting into ions. Okay, so please note down these small things, that ionization is the word is used for the process of splitting into ions. Okay, and there is one another word which is called dissociation. Okay, dissociation is also used for the same process. Dissociation or ionization, both of them are splitting of a compound into its ions. So zinc chloride will split. Okay, what will be the ions? Zinc chloride. Tell me the two ions zinc chloride will split into. Come on, boys. positive and negative. Which one will be positive, zinc or chlorine?
Zinc, ma'am, zinc.
Zinc, yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, zinc is positive, 2 positive plus chloride ion. Okay, Cl negative. And they, as there are 2 chlorides, in one molecule of zinc chloride, there are 2 chlorine atoms. Okay, so to balance it, we will write 2 here, 2 chloride ions. Okay, 2 chlorine atoms will give 2 chloride ions. Okay, to write the ions, you can simply write like this, that these numbers, the numbers which are here written with the elements, these numbers are written always in cross manner. Okay, so this 2 of Cl actually belongs to zinc. Okay, so that is why zinc 2 plus. And this 1 of zinc is one atom, and this 1 actually belongs to chlorine. So that is why chlorine is 1 minus. Okay, so that's how you will write the ions, so that which ions are produced. Okay, so Zn 2 plus, is it cation or anion? Positive.
Cation.
Very good, cation. And the negative one is?
Anion.
Yeah, positive cation will move towards which electrode?
Negative
cathode, and negative anion will move towards positive anode. Okay, please boys, listen to it carefully. Okay, and cation, positive ion will move towards cathode, and negative anion will move towards anode. Okay, now we will write the half equations. Half equations are, they will tell us that what will happen at cathode and what will happen at anode. Okay, when positive ions, like see this one, first one, Zn2+, when it goes to the cathode, at the cathode we know that cathode is negative. Okay, and zinc ion, Zn2+ ions will move to the cathode. Okay, plus sign means, when we were studying the redox reactions, I told you that whenever any species is positive, positive means it has shortage of electrons. It has deficiency. Do you remember?
Yes, ma'am.
Other boys can also speak. Okay, I will not scold you. Okay, you guys can also speak. Shortage of electrons. Positive sign always. If whenever any species, any ion is positive, positive means it has a deficiency of electrons. Okay, shortage of electrons. So Zn positive, it will go to cathode. On the cathode, it will take 2 electrons and become zinc metal, neutral. Okay, it has a shortage of 2 electrons, so it will take 2 electrons from cathode. And as for the chloride ion, chloride is negative. Okay, this negative means it has extra electrons. Okay, extra negative means extra electrons. So it will give up those extra electrons, minus 2 negative. So 2 chloride ions minus 2 electrons. It will give up 2 electrons and become chlorine gas. Okay, this is what happens at anode. At cathode, the gaining of electrons is happening. At anode, the loss of electrons is happening. Okay, so at cathode, reduction happens or oxidation? At cathode, what is happening? Reduction or oxidation?
Reduction.
What do the other boys think?
Ma'am, oxidation.
What is happening on the cathode? First tell me this. Zinc is positive, so it is taking electrons or losing?
Ma'am, it is losing electrons.
Zinc.
Ma'am, it is taking.
It's already, it has shortage of electrons. Okay, so it's gaining plus 2 positive. It is gaining electrons. So here the gain of electrons is happening. So at cathode, reduction happens. Okay, reduction is happening at cathode because reduction is the gain of electrons and zinc is gaining. Okay, and on the other hand, at anode, chloride ions, the minus means extra electrons. So they have extra electrons, so it is losing the electron, losing those extra electrons and becoming chlorine gas, neutral. Okay, it's losing. So here the loss of electrons is happening. So loss of electrons is oxidation. So anode, at anode, oxidation happens. Okay, boys, so it should be on your fingertips that at cathode, reduction happens and at anode, oxidation happens. Okay, always remember, at cathode, reduction happens, at anode, oxidation happens. Okay, whenever any metal comes towards cathode, it will gain the electrons. And whenever any element goes to anode, it will always lose their electrons. Okay? Is it clear? Boys, please give response. Okay, I'm trying my best to explain you, but if you don't give me response, then how would I know that are you getting it or not? Please show some response.
We're getting it.
Okay, so say it now. Okay, so now what are the products? The products are the actual products of this reaction. The overall reaction is zinc chloride. Okay, it will give zinc metal and chlorine gas. Okay, so the actual products of this reaction, of this electrolysis, is zinc metal and chlorine gas. So what we will see at cathode. Okay, after getting discharged, this zinc ions, they will become zinc metal, and we will see zinc metal, the brown zinc metal, depositing at cathode, on the sides of cathode. Okay, so zinc metal, it starts depositing or sticking on the sides of cathode. So we can take out the cathode later on after the experiment and we scratch the zinc. Okay, we can take it off from the cathode, we can scratch it.
Okay, ma'am.
So that's how we will get pure zinc metal, okay, in this electrolysis. So we can extract zinc. And from the anode side, we will see tiny bubbles, small bubbles of chlorine gas coming out. Okay, what is the color of chlorine?
Ma'am, it is a little bit greenish color.
Yeah, yellowish green in color. Okay, so we will see tiny bubbles of chlorine gas coming out from the anode side. Okay, there are lots of videos of electrolysis on YouTube. Okay, so you can search the electrolysis of zinc chloride or electrolysis of lead bromide. So you can actually see the video. In the video, they will show you that how the zinc is forming, is depositing on cathode, and how anode, there like small bubbles of chlorine gas are forming on the anode side. Okay, if I get time, inshallah, so I will show you those videos, okay? Or otherwise, you can also search in your free time. Have you understood this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me, what are the products of electrolysis of zinc chloride?
Zn and Cl.
Zn2 plus plus 2Cl minus 1.
That's the mistake most of the students make. The actual products of electrolysis are not the ions. Okay, the actual products are the metal and the gas which we get in the end. Okay, so if it comes that what are the products of electrolysis of zinc chloride, then you will write zinc metal and chlorine gas. Okay, these are the products. The ions are the
actual. They stick to the cathodes and anodes, right?
Yeah, they will remain. They will stick. So we can later on collect it. Ions are unstable stages. They are middle stages. They are just carriers. Okay, they will go. They will fall. They will be formed. Like after splitting of the compound, the ions will form. They will go to the respective electrodes and discharge. So the actual product which we get in the end, which is stable, is the metal and the gas which we get, okay, in the end. Okay, so now if you have understood this, you can understand lead bromide also. Okay, lead bromide is also very easy. Lead bromide, we will take molten lead bromide. Molten means we will take liquid lead bromide, and when the electricity is passed, it will split into lead ions and bromide ions. Okay, again, we will write the ions in the same form, this 2 is of lead, so we will get lead 2 plus. Okay, and lead is 1, so 1 belongs to bromine, so it's Br minus. Okay, and because there are 2 bromine atoms, so 2 bromine atoms will give 2 bromide ions. Okay, so it will be like this. So sometimes it comes in the questions that when PbBr2 or any compound, when it splits, what are the ions? Okay, so you have to guess the ions and you have to write the proper ions in the charges. Okay, so lead ion is positive, it will move towards negative electrode, and bromide ions are negative, they will go to positive electrode. Okay, tell me the name of the negative electrode.
Cathode.
Very good. And negative, positive?
Anode.
Very good. Okay, so the diagram, you can see that lead ions are moving towards cathode. Okay, being positive, they are moving towards negative electrode, and bromide ions are negative, so they are moving towards positive anode. Okay, now let's see the half equations. Okay, the half equations, what will happen at cathode and what is happening at anode. Okay, we know that cathode is negative, so lead ions will move towards cathode. Okay, again, tell me the positive sign. What does positive sign means?
It means that it loses
that
two electrons.
It has lost. Okay, means in the past tense, yes, not it will lose. Okay, it has lost means it has a shortage of electrons now. Okay, yes, it has deficiency. Ma'am. Okay, it has deficiency, yes, of electrons. So it will take 2 electrons and become lead metal. Neutral. Okay, yeah, lead, neutral lead or lead metal. First of all, it will form in the liquid form. Okay, molten lead, because if electricity is continuously passing, then the system will become hot. It will become warm. Okay, so first we will not get lead in the solid form. It's really, really hot. So we get lead in the liquid form and we settle down at the bottom. Okay, which later on when we take it out, then it will, at room temperature, it will become stiff. It will become hard. Okay, first of all, lead is in the molten form. So we get molten lead here. Okay, but lead metal. In short, we will say that lead metal. Even if we don't know that, that is it molten form or solid form, we can just write lead metal, that we are getting lead metal in the end. And here the gain of electrons is happening. The lead ions are gaining the electrons, so it's reduction. Okay, as I told you that at cathode, always reduction happens. Because always at the cathode is negative. So metal ions are always positive. So always positive ions will move towards cathode. So obviously, if the positive ions are going, so positive ions will gain the electrons. Okay, so there's reduction happening at cathode. And at anode, bromide ions, negative bromide ions will go and they will lose the electrons. Okay, 2 bromide ions will lose 2 electrons and they will become bromine gas. Okay. So there are 2 ways to write this. One way is this, when you write minus 2 electrons, means it is losing 2 electrons and becoming bromine gas. Okay, and you can also write the equation in this manner, that 2 bromide ions, it's becoming bromine gas after losing 2 electrons. Okay, so you can write these electrons on the other side of the equation also in the product. Both of the ways are correct. Okay, you can write in any of the form. If you find this minus 1 easy, so you can write this, both of them are correct. No one will wrong it. Okay. Now, what is happening on anode? Loss or gain?
Loss.
Yeah, loss. Okay, minus sign means extra electrons. So it is losing those extra electrons and becoming neutral bromine gas. Okay, so oxidation is happening, loss of electrons. So what are the 2 products now of lead bromide?
Pb and Br2.
Yeah, the 2 products of electrolysis of lead bromide are lead metal and bromine gas. Okay, these are the products. Products are actually which will form in the end. Okay, they are the products which will form in the end. So ions are not formed in the end. They are the middle stage. So we will not write ions as the products. The products are the end things which we get. Okay, this is the picture from your book. Okay, the same equations are written of lead, which I told you, the lead equations and the bromine equations, same they are written, and it's explained also that two electrons from the electrode, lead ion will take two electrons and bromine ion will lose the electrons. This one, this, it will become bromine gas after losing two electrons. Okay, and see this diagram. In this diagram, the electrodes are connected with the battery. Okay, we are using molten lead bromide and strong heat proof container. Okay, why we are using heat proof container? Right now I told you like some minutes before.
We're using molten lead.
Yeah, we are using molten lead. It's warm, hot, and also due to the passage of continuous electricity, also it becomes hot. Okay, when continuously electricity is passing from something, then it becomes warm, it becomes hot. So we are using heat proof so that we can handle it also. Okay, we can hold it also. So after the experiment, we can take out the lead from it. Okay, so lead metal, first of all, it is in the liquid form, but at room temperature, it will start making its beads. Okay, it will start becoming hard and stiff, because at room temperature, we know that all the metals are solid. Okay, so it will start becoming warm, hard. And this one, you must use a fume cupboard. So why we are using fume cupboard?
So that bromine does not escape.
Yeah, so that bromine does not escape. Okay, remember that if we do the experiment, or if we are doing the electrolysis in which we are getting some halogens or some harmful gas, like fluorine is harmful, fluorine, chlorine, bromine. Okay, these gases, they are harmful, toxic, okay, toxic, poisonous. So if these gases are produced in any of the experiment, so we have to do this in a closed fume cupboard, okay, so that these gases does not escape in the air. Okay, and then the diagram, same diagram, everything. Okay, after this, there is one more example of electrolysis of molten compounds. In this table, you can go through it by yourself. It's very easy. Okay, lead bromide. Okay, first one, electrolyte. They're just given the examples. That lead bromide, when it decomposes, it will give lead and bromine. Okay, and what is the cathode reaction and what will be the anode reaction? And sodium chloride, similarly, it will give sodium and chlorine. Okay, and what will be the cathode reaction, anode reaction? Potassium iodide, copper bromide, similarly. Okay, they have given the cathode reaction and anode reaction and the actual products in the end. Okay. And in the end of, at the end of this page, there is one topic, this one. This is extraction of aluminium. Okay, extracting aluminium from its ore, bauxite. So this one is very, very important. Okay. This is, although it's a small topic in your book, but it's very important, okay? Lots of past paper questions are related to extraction of aluminium. The diagram labeling can also come, okay? The labeling of its diagram and to write its half equation and why we are using cryolite and what is the name of aluminium, or like small questions in this. So this is really important, extraction of aluminium. So we'll discuss it in detail in the next class, okay? Right now, I will just tell you that extraction of aluminium is done on the large scale, okay? Industrial electrolysis of molten aluminium oxide. So we do this extraction of aluminium on a large scale because aluminium has lots of uses. Do you know where it is used? Aluminium metal.
Cars.
Aluminium is used to make car bodies. Okay, car bodies, it is also used to make airplane bodies. Okay, and it is used to make ship bodies. So their bodies, because they are big vehicles, so their bodies also, they need large amount of aluminium. Okay, so aluminium is very less dense Less dense means it's very light in weight. Okay, it's aluminium is hard, is very hard, but it's less dense. So being very light, it is used in making aeroplane bodies. Okay, and it is used in making ship bodies because it has anti-rust properties also. Okay, it will not rust because it forms the layer of oxide around itself. Okay, when aluminium it comes in contact with oxygen, it forms aluminium oxide, and aluminium oxide it actually acts as a shield around aluminium metal. So it forms a shield. It will not allow any water and oxygen to react and rust. Okay, so it is anti-rust also. And ships, we know that ships are continuously in contact with water. Okay, so that's why we use aluminium to make ship bodies also. Okay, so aluminium is extracted on a large scale by using this setup. Okay, so inshallah we'll discuss it in the next class, and then we'll start electrolysis of solutions.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, and for Mubashir, I will check. Okay, Alafis, see you tomorrow.
Alafis, ma'am.
Alafis, ma'am.
Alafis.